We've been using maps for a very long time to portray the spatial relationships among things that are important to us. They guide us to where we want to go, show us information about the places we visit, and provide us with a record of how the world has changed through time. On some maps, the patterns we observe are shaped by natural forces of landscape evolution, vegetation ecology, and soil formation. These maps speak to me about what a particular landscape is like, how the soil would feel beneath your shoes, or if you could touch it with your hand. Other maps reflect our modern relationship to the land, including the human imprint of settlement, agriculture development, forestry, and infrastructure. And these maps often trace those natural patterns of land and soil. For example, farming is normally confined to areas where the slopes are gentle and the soils contain few rocks. And forest harvest occurs where rainfall is adequate and in mountainous landscapes where soil materials are thick enough to support productive tree growth. For all these reasons, soil maps have been prepared and used in Canada for nearly 100 years. This particular map was prepared in 1954 as part of BC Soil Survey Report No. 7. Maps like this one were prepared for many areas of the province with the primary purpose to guide agricultural development in the day to those favorable soils I just described. But soil map production in those days was carried out using analog techniques of cartography, and map production in the new era is transforming to digital techniques, in part to better represent the many other ways that soil supports our modern lives, and including its connection with big problems like climate change. I think we're all familiar with the way that soils nurture and support the plant communities that fix carbon from the atmosphere, and that much of that carbon fixed ends up in the soil humus. But a lesser known fact is that the majority of the carbon in our ecosystems is stored below ground. Think about that for a moment. Everything we see above ground as we walk through the forest accounts for less than half of the total carbon that's stored there. And processes within the soil mediate and control the transfer of carbon between the land and the atmosphere in an ongoing process. These processes are hidden from our view as we go about our daily lives. So soil maps are one way that we can focus a light on this key component, this key transfer point in the global carbon cycle. To make a soil map in the traditional way, surveyors would review air photographs and other information to obtain an understanding of landform for a particular area. In this case, a portion of the Dead Man River Valley near Kamloops. Boundaries were drawn, and soil pits were dug to obtain information about the soil conditions within each of those predefined landscape units. In this way, a color-coded map was prepared that related the soil distribution across the landscape to the environmental factors of soil parent material, topography, vegetation, and climate. A great example of the digital transformation I just mentioned is BC's Soil Information Finder tool. The SIFT tool, as it's affectionately known by us soil scientists, combines those spatial and descriptive data into a digital database, which is available on the internet in an interactive web mapping platform. Because these data are so available, people looking for information on the soils of BC find the SIFT tool a very popular destination in their search for information. But landscapes can't always be divided into discrete units with sharp boundaries like those shown here. So even those modern representations of the traditional maps have their limitations. The modern approach, the new approach, considers mapping locations based on their XY coordinates on a spatial grid. And computer algorithms known as machine learners evaluate the soil and environmental conditions at each grid location so that the resulting maps can be color-coded just like the old ones, but they're much better suited for quantitative analysis of those relationships, as well as for error checking and updating with new information. This particular map is available on the Hectares BC website, and it shows the soil parent materials for that particular area, as well as the entire province, the whole data set does, and it was prepared using a random forest prediction algorithm. But just what is the role of the soil scientist in this new era? Well, just as before, our job is to understand and interpret those soil landscape relations, but also to collect the data necessary to train those machine learners, primarily through fieldwork, which is just as strenuous as it was in those early times. There's no free lunch, even in the digital age, and the old-fashioned shovel remains a very important part of the modern soil scientist's toolkit. Recently, soil scientists within BC and across Canada collaborated to prepare a map of the carbon stocks in Canadian soils for the entire landmass of Canada. This was our contribution to the Food and Agriculture Organization's Global Soil Organic Carbon Map, which was prepared on World Soils Day, December 5th, 2017. The dark areas on this map reveal in greater detail than ever before the significant carbon reserves in Canada's forests, in the north, and on BC's west coast. But just as how exactly are such maps being used? For me, their greatest value is the fact that they focus our attention on those areas of the landscape where the greatest amounts of carbon are stored. For example, in low-lying parts of our landscapes where water accumulates and prevents the decomposition of organic matter. These areas need to be recognized and considered in our management planning and our management practices to prevent the loss of carbon stored there to the atmosphere. New maps being prepared with LIDAR data sets are providing the location information on these areas in greater detail than ever before, so the planning can occur at a finer and finer scale. Another thing that we're learning from the new maps is the significant carbon reserves that are located in the humus forms lying at the surface of our forest soils. And in particular, these carbon pools are especially susceptible to loss caused by wildfire. The new world of digital soil mapping is fueled by technology, ready access to spatial data, and an active community of mappers and modelers. Many of them are young people with combined interest in computers and a passion for the natural world. The availability of the spatial data is improving all the time, so these maps are getting better and better. And their ability to help us as we face the problems of today and tomorrow is dependent on access to that data. So these maps will continue to help us in the future and recognize new opportunities from the land, just like the previous generation of soil maps helped guide our province in those earlier years. Thank you.